Good morning, my reader friends. My name is Erin Rogoff, and welcome back to my BookTube channel, where today we will be doing a re-review of Crank. I would say that Crank is one of my favorite books to reread, just because I never get tired of it, and it's just so interesting to me. Anyway, Crank is a young adult fiction dark poetry novel, and there are triggers for drug abuse and sexual assault. There are three books in the Crank trilogy, and they are Crank, and Glass, and Fallout. Fallout is told in the point of views of three of Kristina Snow's kids, Hunter, Autumn, and Summer. There are several other books by Ellen Hopkins, and they include Identical. This book is single-handedly the hardest book that I have ever read in my life. And then we have Tilt, which is a book in my DNF zone. And then we have Rumble. I have this book, but I have not read it in full. And then we have Tricks. I have this book as well, but I also have not read it yet. And then we have People Kill People. I did have this book, but I gave it to my best friend to read, and I really hope she enjoys reading it more than I did, because it was less than what I hoped for. Moving on. With an in-depth summary, we start out with Kristina Snow as a Nevada native teenage girl who goes on a visit to see her dad in Albuquerque after the court orders visitation. During Kristina's visit to see her dad, she meets a boy named Adam, but friends call him Buddy. And speaking of alter egos, Kristina comes up with one of her own, Bree. Adam offers Kristina Crank, which is meth amphetamines, and afterwards she is hooked, which changes her life forever and every day afterwards. She goes to the bowling alley where her dad works, smokes cigarettes, gets high on meth, makes out with Adam, sleeps for 20 hours at a time, then gets high again, which is not exactly in that order because it does revolve around those things, and it just, it isn't pretty, but it is eye-opening, so in a way, it is still incredible. Moving on. Adam gives Kristina a tattoo, his way of making her remember him before she leaves. And then once home, Kristina feels the desire to get high and smoke, then sleeps a whole day and passes it along as jet lag. How long is that gonna last, Kristina? There's a corporate party for Kristina's stepdad, and she wonders how she'll be able to hide her now infected tattoo. Time to bring in the help of her sister Lee, who is a nursing major. And the corporate party? It's at a water park, so really there's no hiding the tattoo if you're dressed in a bikini. Kristina then meets two new guys, Brendan and Chase. Will they help her get over Adam, who does request an open relationship so he can date another girl in Albuquerque while Kristina is allowed to date anyone else she likes? Moving on, Brendan is a hot lifeguard who isn't all a stand-up guy, and that's all I'm going to say about that right now. And then Chase didn't have a crush on Kristina before, but he does now. And on a date with Brendan, he sexually assaults Kristina, unknowingly getting her pregnant. And then Kristina doesn't tell anyone except Chase, who now says that he is in love with her. Eventually, Kristina comes clean to her mom about being sexually assaulted and being pregnant. And this scene gets harsh when Kristina tells her mom why she didn't tell her sooner, because Kristina didn't think that her mom would care, which is really a shocking scene. That's just my opinion anyway. Picking up speed with the summary, Kristina sneaks out of her family's house and then gets in trouble with the police, and then she slips up through her pregnancy and gets high and smokes cigarettes more than a few times. And then Kristina considers having an abortion, and then changes her mind when she feels baby Hunter Seth kick inside her, and she becomes determined to step up and be the mother that baby Hunter deserves. And the book ends with Kristina delivering Hunter, and her story continues with the sequel, Glass. I would like to talk a little bit about the author Ellen Hopkins. She is a New York Times bestselling author. She lives in Carson City, Nevada with her husband and son. She's on social media and gets thousands of texts from teenagers claiming that she is the only one who seems to understand them. I will leave a link to her website in the description below. She says that books are her life, reading is one of her passions, and writing is the biggest part of her. And as a writer and a reader, I totally agree with you, Ellen Hopkins. Ellen Hopkins also says that balance is her greatest challenge, which I understand as well. And Ellen Hopkins also loves her family, friends, and home, loves her pets, loves to travel, and loves to meet her readers. Moving on to a favorite quote that stuck out to me more than any of the others. Everything shut down. Cerebral ghost town. I fell into sleep. Deep, dream-free sleep. I can relate to this quote because even though I have never done drugs in my life, I have struggled with depression for a long time, and when I have my worst bouts of depression, all I want to do is sleep, and I don't dream in those moments, which furthers my depression because I do depend on dreams as a way of inspiring me to write, so that's always difficult for me, but I am doing so much better mentally, and I do recommend writing in journals because then you can really get your thoughts out. Moving on to ratings. Amazon rates the book 4.7 out of 5 stars. Barnes & Noble rates this book 4.5 out of 5 stars. Booksamillion.com rates the book 4.3 out of 5 stars. Goodreads rates the book 4.1 out of 5 stars. According to Google users, 92% of people enjoyed this book, and my rating, 5 out of 5 stars hands down. There are so many reviews for this book. Kirkus Reviews says this book is powerful and unsettling. Student Library Journal, SLJ, says these poems are masterpieces of word, shape, and pacing. A stunning portrayal of a teen's loss of direction. Voices of Youth Advocates, Boya, says Ellen Hopkins delivers a gritty, fast-paced read. As far as final notes go, the book length is 576 pages, and the time that it will take to read this book, roughly 2 hours and 40 minutes. And even though this book seems long and is 2 inches thick of literary excellence, the poetry is written in free verse and very little is actually written on many of the pages, so this is really a quick read. Speaking on a more realistic note instead of just literary fiction, I have had friends fall into the drug abyss, and I did not like what I saw them go through. And the only highs I like chasing are natural adrenaline highs, like the ones I get after ziplining, or horseback riding, rock climbing or snowboarding with my brother, canoe racing with my dad, or speed kayaking with my grandpa and aunt, which is a summer tradition for the three of us. And I know I'm going totally off topic here, but drugs give you a placebo happy. The happy that you feel when you're high isn't real and it's dangerous, because what I am trying to say is there's more to life than drugs, so you can find you are happy without them, I implore you guys. And I do agree with a lot of these drug rehabilitation places that say reading crank is one of the requirements, and I have never been on drugs, but I read this every single year, I never regret it. It is so powerful every single time you read it, or at least it is for me. So this is definitely one of the books that I highly recommend to almost anyone, whether or not you are on drugs. Anyway, that is all for today, so if you enjoyed this video, hit that like button to show some support, subscribe to my BookTube channel to get more videos like this, turn those notifications on to be notified when I have a brand new video uploaded every other day, keep on reading, and have a great day, everyone!